me. Good morning. Welcome to Roots Week 2020, the fierce urgency of now. Thank you for joining us this morning. Before we get started, let's have our language justice partners, Bunch of Linguists, walk us through our language access.
Hola, muy buenos días. Para quienes nos acompañan hoy, por favor sepan que estamos proveyendo interpretación del español al inglés y del inglés al español. Para acceso del lenguaje, por favor envíen un mensaje al chat de transmisión en vivo y nuestro equipo técnico les enviará un enlace al cual pueden acceder.
For our viewers watching the live stream, please know that we're providing interpretation from Spanish to English and English to Spanish. For language access, please send a message in the live stream chat and our tech team will send a link for you to access.
Hola, mi nombre es Sabina y mis pronombres son ella, ellas, y estoy aquí con mi compa y co-intérprete Julie, sus pronombres él, ellas. Somos miembros del colectivo de justicia del lenguaje Bancha Lenguas, basado en Bulbancha, Louisiana.
Hey, my name is Sabina and my pronouns are she, hers, and I am joined today by my comrade and co-interpreter, Julie, whose pronouns are he, they. We are members of Bancha Lenguas Language Justice Collective, based in Bulbancha, Louisiana.
Bulbancha es la palabra Choctaw que significa la tierra donde se habla muchos lenguajes.
Bulbancha is the Choctaw word, which means the land where many languages are spoken.
Como trabajadores de justicia del lenguaje, nos esforzamos a crear un espacio para que todos aquí presentes puedan entender y ser entendidos en el idioma en que nos sentimos más poderosos.
As language justice workers, we strive to create space for everyone here to understand and be understood in the language in which we feel most powerful.
To create this space, please speak at a slow and steady pace. If you're speaking too fast, you will see us making this hand signal, which means to slow down. We invite you to do this as well. It may be hard to see us on your screen, so we ask that you please keep an eye on the chat in case we send a message asking you to slow down.
Para crear este espacio, por favor, habla a un paso lento y constante. Si estás hablando muy rápido, nos verás hacer esta señal de manos que significa ir más despacio. Le invitamos a que haga también esta seña. Es posible que sea difícil vernos en su pantalla, así que le pedimos que le echen un ojo al chat por si enviamos un mensaje pidiendo que vayas más despacio.
Speak loudly and clearly. If you have headphones with mic, please use them. We will make the hand signal if we can't hear you. You all are invited to do the same.
Dice aquí, habla en voz alta y clara. Si tienes audífonos con micrófono, utilícelos. Haremos esta señal con la mano si no podemos escucharle. Están todos invitados a hacer lo mismo.
Keep your mic on mute when you are not speaking.
Mantén tu micrófono en silencio si no estás hablando.
One speaker at a time. Interpreters can only interpret one voice at a time. We don't want to be in a position of having to decide which voice to privilege over another.
Una persona a la vez. Los intérpretes solamente pueden interpretar una voz a la vez. No queremos estar en la posición de tener que decir cuál voz privilegiar sobre otra.
Y ahora vamos a aprender la plataforma para la interpretación.
And now we will turn on the interpretation platform.
Si estás usando una computadora, vas a ver un icono de globo al pie de tu pantalla con la palabra interpretación. Haz clic sobre él y selecciona el canal de lenguaje preferido, inglés o español.
If you're using a computer, you will see a globe icon at the bottom of your screen with the word interpretation. Click on it and select the channel with the language of your choice, which is English or Spanish for now.
Si están usando un teléfono inteligente o una tableta, busca tres puntitos que leen más. Haz clic, te aparecerá un... haz clic sobre interpretación, selecciona inglés o español y luego haces clic sobre finalizar.
If you're using a smartphone or tablet, look for three dots that read more. Click on it and this will prompt a list. Click on interpretation, select English or Spanish, then click done.
Y ahora vamos a asignar a mi compañera Julie como intérprete.
Mm-hmm. I'm just waiting for the... Okay, there we go.
Now you can click on either language. And as I switch, you should hear my co-interpreter interpreting in the language you have selected. Cuando estés listo, envía un pulgarcito arriba con tus reacciones de pantalla. If you have any issues with tech, please send a message to our host, Wendy. We'll see you on the other side. Thank you.
Thank you, Bancha. We appreciate you growing with us. I'm Paige Hurton. I am the caretaker, peacemaker, and implementer on the operations team at Alternate Roots. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. And I am zooming in from the land of the Muskogee in Atlanta, Georgia. I am a white cisgender female wearing a green sweater. I have red hair. And behind me is a white wall with an open door. And so, Bob, did you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Good morning, everyone. My name is Bob Leonard. I'm this early morning. I'm glad to be with you all. My pronouns I use are he, him, his. I'm a white man, cisgendered, got white hair, white beard, short, and a sweater because it's a fall day here. I'm in my study with a doorway with no door, but an open passageway behind me. I work at Virginia Tech in the town of Blacksburg, which is on the Monacan and Tutelo land.
Great. So Alternate Roots is supported by generous donations from our members, private individuals, and funders, including the National Endowment for the Arts, the Ford, Mellon, Cerdna, and Doris Duke Foundations.
We like to keep our purpose pretty clear and present so that all know what we mean to be doing and can hold us accountable for doing it. Alternate Roots supports artists in the southern United States who are working to eliminate all forms of oppression.
We invite you to be active in the chat stream. If you're having other technical issues, please reach out via the chat and we'll have someone assist you.
We also like to keep it clear how folks like to be addressed and recognized. So please take a moment to change your name so that people know your pronouns, your preferred pronouns, and any other aspect on your name here on the Zoom world frame.
And as you're adding your pronouns to your profile, drop in the chat where you're zooming in from. If you know the names of the indigenous people who are stewards of the land you're currently occupying, drop that into the chat too. If not, we invite you to learn more about land acknowledgement. One website that you can go to for information is nativeland.ca. They will be dropping that in the chat, but there are also many other websites that you can also visit.
Quick reminder, no matter how Roots convenes, whether in physical space or virtually, or through our own connectivity, we do so under the guidance of our community agreements. We'll drop the link into the chat for your reference so that we can keep together on how we have come together by agreement.
And our wellness team reminds us to take care of ourselves while we're in this virtual space. Grab some water, snacks as needed, take breaks, and be good to your body during Roots Week. All right, so I guess that ends announcements. Let's get the session started. The wonderful Wendy is going to introduce our presenters today.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. I'm Wendy Schenefeld, the auntie of cultural exuberance and sanctuary for Alternate Roots. I am so happy to be here this morning after, you know, auntie was up way too late last night with the pop-up cinema hosted by House of Pentacles, but it was marvelous, amazing. So worth me having a little extra bags this morning. So first up this morning, I need to tell you a little bit about me. So Wendy, she, her, hers, zooming in from the ancestral lands of the Choctaw and Natchez people in the Republic of Jaffrica, also known as Jackson, Mississippi. And I am a light-skinned Black woman. Lord, I must need more coffee. Let me start over. Let me slow down. I am a light-skinned Black woman with curly hair, Black glasses, and a red lip. I am wearing a dashiki in honor of my sister Tufara this morning, and I have artwork behind me. And it is my pleasure this morning to start our grounding, which clearly I need this morning. So we're going to start with a grounding from the wonderful Dr. Doris Davenport. And we'll need to get, there we go. Thank you.
Shall I start? Sorry, good morning, everyone. Good morning and blessings to you. Thank you. I am coming to you this morning on behalf of the wellness team of which I am a part to bring the grounding meditation for this morning. Basically a few deep breaths, maybe a few giggles. I find I'm getting very silly as I age, Bob, and sillier. And I would like to begin, please, then, with just a repetition of today's affirmation. This was in our email. My efforts are being supported by the universe. My dreams manifest into reality before my eyes. Thank you for whoever shared that. I am Doris Diosa Davenport. Sometimes known as Mama Doris, sometimes known as Dr. D. My pronouns are person and per. I have been a Roots member since maybe 1994. And I met the wonderful Tufara back in there. So I'm honored to be here doing this on her panel, if I could call it that. I bring you joy and greetings from the Cherokee homeland of Northeast Georgia, recolonized as Cornelia, Georgia, but I also know it as my home. There is a small area in this community, in this little town, small area called The Hill. I specifically am bringing you greetings from my hometown community. Does my heart good to be able to say that. So what we'll do first is, and if we can't even have any coffee, let's get these shoulder shrugs going. Let me see them shoulders move. Come on, please. Thank you. Forwards or back, stand up if you feel like it, feet flat on the floor. Now, here's something you don't do often. I need you to say, good morning, feet, and look down that way. Good morning, feet. We don't pay enough attention to our feet. Say, I love your feet. Okay. Okay. Gentle shoulder shrugs. Yes. Because one day your feet will start talking back to you. You might not like what they tell you. Love them now. There you go, Bob. Twist a little bit. Twist around a little bit. And then deep breath in and head back just a little. Drop your head to your chest. And while it's there, I want to hear you mumbling about everything that you've been worrying about. Money, food, voting, money, food, voting, money, food. And breathe in. Head up, let it go. Breathe in and out. Now, arms, you got to get arms in there. Get these arms in here. And breathing up and down. I forgot to set my timer. Now, I want you to come with me here. I want you to come here in this sacred space of the Cherokee via time travel. We published this book in 1995. I lived on Sequi Street. Sequi is a Cherokee word. We always knew that. Turned black on the hill across the railroad track in Appalachian foothills, where madness like morning glories took over everyone, trying to be insane and acceptable all the time, and all the time painted. Mac, our cousin, said he saw a casket roll down Sequi Street. He said it stopped in front of 103 Sequi Street and rolled back up the hill again. Why do they stay there, you ask? Why do they live there? We were a sweet reservation on Cherokee land, on a beautiful hill of apartheid reserved for the coloreds. And though many of us honestly had and have Indian blood, we had short memories, dreams, and amnesia. The Cherokee could have traveled to Northeast Georgia to look at us, making not bees and moccasins, but reinventing each other every day on this sacred land in Northeast Georgia, recolonized as Cornelia, but what we know as the Hill, our home. I invite you to partake of some of that beauty this morning and let that too be a part of your meditation. So if you could close with another deep breath in. Bob Leonard is doing a dance, and I can see your butt, Bob Leonard. I'm meditating. Good for you, Bob. Bob's shaking it, y'all, okay? Another deep breath in. And joy and blessings to you all from the Hill in Northeast Georgia, Cherokee homeland. Ashe, thank you. Good morning. I'm done.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That I needed that grounding personally, so I appreciate that. Beautiful. And to get our bodies moving. So if we didn't quite have enough coffee or tea this morning, our blood should now be moving a little bit. And, you know, it's always a good day when we can get Bob Leonard to shake his butt on camera. There we go. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Doris Davenport.
Thank you.
So next up, we are going to have a gallery talk. So to the theme, the fierce urgency of now, we're in our final weekend of Roots Week, and now is what we are concentrating on today. So now is about intergenerational work. It's about our youths. It is about our elders and everyone in between. So I'm pleased to bring now, and I'm going to let them introduce themselves, Kayla.
Thank you, Wendy. Hi, everyone. I'm Kayla Foreman, she, her pronouns. I'm from Baltimore, Maryland, born and raised there, and I'm currently living here. I mostly paint, but I also do some photography and some digital collages, which you'll see when I share my screen. And right now I am in front of my work. I'm in my studio at home. So my work for the last few years has been about my exploration of my family, my home, my memory, all this being catalyzed by certain experiences I had growing up, like losing a parent or saying goodbye to a home that I spent so much time in. Experiencing these events encouraged me to want to have a better idea of my family's past and my own. I want to know how they existed before me. I want to have a better knowledge of them now. And this is my way of like processing my feelings and bringing back any repressed memories I have. So because of this, I start my research. I gather old family photos and objects. I have conversations with my family. I screenshot old text messages and I look at my family's presence on social media. This is just to have something to reference when I'm making my work. So this process is very evident in one of my pieces titled 1426, which is about my grandmother's house, which I am about to talk about now and share my screen. So this is 1426. My grandmother's house has been a place for my grandmother, my mother, my aunts, my cousins, and myself to call a home for over 30 years now, until it was demolished in 2017 by Johns Hopkins. Three generations of family lived and grew up in this house. So I feel like our childhoods and lives left along with this house when it was demolished. When I started this piece, I started with a conversation with my grandmother. We talked about the house and our shared memories in it. And I talked about to her making work about it. And I wanted to gather things that she might have had from her house. So she gave me a bunch of stuff. She gave me house decorations. She gave me things that she had from her dining room table. Like you see, this is like under the plate. She gave me a TV tray, which occupies a big part of our memories today. And a hat that I found out was gifted to her by my father when I was a baby, and it has the tag still on it. Meanwhile, while she was gathering all that stuff, I was gathering my own pictures. One of the photos I had was of my father holding that hat, and he had my cousin by his side. So that's this right here. I'll show you. These are some close-ups. I took some of these photos and I made paintings of them. I took some and I printed them and then I drew on top of them and then some of them I just left how they were. But also I had old paintings that also had the idea of home that I painted on top of, like this one here. And well, yeah. So over time, everything built up into what you see now. It's a collection of all these things in one place, made so that you can get closer and feel more intimate with the work as much as I am. I wanted the people looking at this to feel like they were reminiscing with me. So another piece that I'll talk about is titled External. This piece is a direct response to the grief process, specifically mine of my father's death in 2015 when I was 15 years old. Everyone's grief journey is very different. And I found that with mine, I like to keep things in memory of my dad. I kept his clothes, his business cards, his old text messages in my phone, and his letters from when I was a baby. In the early thought process of this painting, I weirdly thought about computers in my high school computer science class. So computers have memory or RAM, which is like memory that's quickly accessed when you need it. Like when you're browsing the internet or playing a game, like you need that RAM to do those like basic tasks. So they need that in order to run. But then there's storage, which is kind of more permanent. That's something that you could go back to later when you want to retrieve something that you had. So I connected that idea with my own memory. It's memories in my head, which I call my own internal memory. And then these memories could be repressed and then brought back when something triggers it. And then I have my external memory, which is things I keep or store when I don't have to, so I won't have to remember it directly. So I have my father's shirt, for instance, which is what I show right here. So it's this, other objects and photos, like text and other things like text messages that I keep and look back at sometimes when I want to remember my father. So just that whole idea was the foundation of this piece. This is an oil painting collage. I started with a blue wash to paint on top of. And then I painted the main focus of the painting, which is that shirt, which he used to wear, and I still have it now sitting in my room. On the bottom right is a painting of an old photo of my father, probably before I was born. And yeah, this picture is from a collection of photos in my basement where I'm at now. On the left side, I have a text message that my father had sent me and my sister a couple weeks before he passed away. And that picture's of him and my grandmother, his mother. That grandmother is not the grandmother I was talking about in the last piece. But I finished the painting with a silhouette of him, which you can see right here. And I incorporated that silhouette in a bunch of other pieces, which you'll see now in this. It's also from a photo from this installation, but I included in other pieces like this one, which is titled Family Portrait. This is a GIF collage that I made with some scans of more photos from my basement, along with the moving silhouette I mentioned earlier. In the center of this GIF is a Polaroid that I dragged through the scanner of my grandmother's Christmas tree. The other photos of my brothers, my mother, my father, my cousins, along with myself when I was younger. This piece was more of an experiment, and I was trying to see how I could put this into the real world. So I projected this image into my living room, my current living room, to see how it looked there. I meant to include a video of that, but I forgot. But I do want to do more of this in the future. So the last piece that I'll talk about quickly is something that I'm currently working on. I'm continuing the idea of my grandmother's house, but focusing more on the architecture and the shapes, along with the old photos, which you see here. This is my mother pregnant with me. I thought about when I came up with the idea for this, I thought of old altar pieces, and I wanted to make a triptych memorial for my grandmother's house. I'm thinking about composition in this piece and trying to figure out how to move the viewer's eye throughout the triptych, like an altarpiece would. This that I have right now is the far left side of the triptych. It's still in progress, so y'all get that glimpse of that. But yeah, that's all I have now. Thank you all for listening, and thank you Alternate Roots for having me be a part of this, along with the Roots Virtual Salon, with many other great artists that I admire a lot. Thank you.
And I think, thank you, Kayla. Amazing work. And thank you to Ambrose, who brought Kayla to our attention. So thank you so much for sharing. We have one or two questions in the chat. Would either one, either Paige or Bob, like to read those?
Yes, let's see. We have, can you talk more about how you have thought about movement and motion in your work, specifically the GIF piece, but also in others?
Mostly that whole idea came through just like experimenting with stuff, but it kind of read like, I don't know how to explain it, but it definitely has some meaning behind it, because since my father is gone, he is that floating thing around us that is just there. So that's how I came up with that. The silhouette, I just used that as from one of the old pictures. Just wanted to create a shape and just experiment with some stuff.
And when did you begin to paint and explore the arts?
I began being an artist, I would say, in the second grade, but I haven't really started painting until maybe my senior year of high school. So that was about 5 years ago, 4 years ago.
And someone asked, do you use acrylics or gouache? But I think you mentioned they were oils. Are they all oils or a mixture of materials?
Yeah, they're all oils.
Okay.
Yeah.
And How has your art been healing for you?
I think this was, my art is a way to like process everything that was going on, because with me, I don't usually like to process my emotions, and I didn't really start talking about this stuff until I started painting in back senior year of high school. So I think this was like, I'm more able to express my emotions now that I'm addressing that in my art. Yeah.
Can you say what a triptych art is?
A triptych is a series of paintings that work together. It's three paintings. So you can have a diptych, which is two paintings, and then you can have a triptych. And then you can have a quadriptych or all of that. But a triptych is three paintings that work together to create an image. You usually see it in like old, like Renaissance stuff, altars and stuff, yeah.
What attracts it to you?
I guess is the, I don't know how to say it. I would say like the passion of it, but it's something about religion and how people portrayed it in like those old art pieces that really like resonated with me.
Nice.
And we had another question about the movement in your work. So the question is, would you say more about the movement between the digital and the physical in your work, especially thinking about painting photographs, paintings of them, paintings on them, and using the scanner?
This, all of that stuff, all the processes and all that is just metaphors of how I process everything myself. So I take old stuff and I just go over it, or I just run it through the scanner and just make it look crazy. I deface stuff. So it's just, it's kind of like how memory works. Like it alters through time.
And let's see, also wondering, is part of your work, you challenge others to tap into memory, or was it mainly in documenting your story and your healing narrative? Projecting your artwork seems like an offering.
It's kind of a little of both, because I'm documenting my family's history while also having people come in and look at these things as if they were their own family photos.
Okay, and this is a really important one. Is there a link for seeing more of your work or supporting you? And are you selling your work?
Yes, my website is kaylaforman.weebly.com. My Instagram is @heykaylaart. My name is spelled K-A-I-L-A-H. And I am selling pieces. So if you want to email me, my name, my email is kayla.forman@gmail.com. Yeah.
Kayla, thank you so much for sharing your work with us. If you can access the chat, maybe you might be able to, there's still questions coming. So if you want to answer any of those in the chat, but also make sure that we have your correct website information so we can continue to support. So let's give it up for Kayla. I love to hear people talk about their work. Thank you, thank you, thank you for sharing. Okay, so now it's time for our big pollination keynote. So look, I'm already starting to get emotional because this person is so important to me. So right, Doris is reminding me. Mama Doris is reminding me.
Right here with you, Wendy.
We've been trying to do this a long time and she finally said yes. So, Tufara Waller Muhammad, it's so important to this work, so important to me personally. But I'm going to get through this because she's going to talk about me so bad when we get off of this. This is why you pre-record things. I just couldn't do it. So our pollination keynotes are part of our Uprooting Impressions series. It's organically grown, custom-made, anti-racism, anti-oppression workshop series. And we've been doing this for some time, and we realized it wasn't just a Roots Week thing, that this is now a year-long 24/7 program that we created because we have so many people who are doing this work, and we did need to hire other people to do this kind of work. So the keynotes, the pollination keynotes, are part of our uprooting series. So we have a fairly large uprooting planning team, and each year we come together and try to think of who would we like to be our pollination keynote speakers. And this year we've heard from, our first one was Kim Pevia, and then next we had Camille Schaefer, and there was unanimous decision on all three of these, including Tufara Waller Muhammad. And in my head, when Tufara's name came up, I said, oh, Tufara doesn't do keynotes. Tufara doesn't do panels. So I'm going to have to call my sister and say, will you please do this for us? And of course, the first answer was what? No. Because as much as Tufara loves Roots, Tufara also has wonderful about boundaries, wonderful about making decisions. When Tufara makes a decision, he sticks with it. And then she said, but I will do it if I can do it in this way. And the only way that Tufara agreed to do it was if it could be a conversation with our youths. Youth at Roots. So these are our under 30 rooters. And I was like, sure, we can do this however you want to, because I just wanted her to say yes. But that speaks to who Tufara is as a teacher, as a leader. She doesn't like that word. As someone who is bringing along the next generation, not as passing the torch, but as equals, equal exchange of information. We're learning and listening together at the same table. Because of COVID, of course, we had to be at our own tables, and you'll be at Tufara's kitchen table in just a moment. I'm not going to read her bio. That's in the program book. Y'all can look at all the wonderful things Tufara has done just very quickly, and we'll get to it. Tufara is one of those people that you might not remember when you met her, because it feels like, for me personally, it feels like Tufara has been in my life my whole life. I think that we actually met on the My Mississippi Eyes Project in Jackson, Mississippi, with Carlton Turner, Maurice Turner, Tufara, Jolivet Anderson. You'll recognize some of these names around the Bob Moses's project. And it was like I'd met her a lifetime ago. And we've worked together and been friends together ever since. I've learned so many lessons from Tufara. One is everybody ain't Christian. And the reminder that if you wouldn't plan something on Christmas, then you shouldn't plan something on high holy days for Muslims or Jewish people either. That we need to make sure that we always have a space for people to be able to pray, for people to be able to center themselves. She's taught me about boundaries and how important it is to have them and stick by them, to stand firm in her beliefs, to stop code switching. That as Black folk, we can have all the degrees in the world. We can have, it doesn't matter, that we should feel comfortable enough to speak the language of our own people, our family talk, that we should be okay with doing that, occupying whatever spaces that we occupy. So we shouldn't have to code switch. To be beautiful in all of the glory that we are as Black people. The power of intergenerational work. Part of our culture says that if there aren't babies and elders in the room, then we're not doing the real work. Because the people that do this real work are the caretakers. They're the ones that are taking care of the babies. They're the ones that are supporting the elders. And that's part of the lessons I've learned from Tufara. And the need to provide support. That our brain work is not free work. we've given enough free labor that if we're asking for young people, if we're asking for elders, if we're asking for folks to come and sit and be part of these groups and getting ideas from them, that we need to be paying them for their thoughts. So enough of me talking. I want to get to this brilliance that is my dear friend. What we're going to have to do, we're going to switch over to the live stream. So for those of you that are, don't do it quite yet, but if you can, please drop in the live stream link, if you're not already on it, in the chat, so we'll know to switch over there. But it is my deep, deep, deep pleasure and privilege to bring to you, in combination with Utes, my friend, my teacher, my co-conspirator, my sister. And this almost didn't happen, y'all. We lost so many people this year. And I called Tufara and said, you do not have to do this, because we're grieving right now. And we want to make sure that you're okay. And Tufara said, no, I need to do this. I need to do this. I need to share this moment with young people. And we're going to have a real conversation. So I bring to you a real conversation with Tufara Waller Muhammad and Utes.
Good morning, everybody. I'm bringing you greetings and kind words from the great state of Arkansas and the kitchen table. I want to talk to you a little bit in this pollination that I intentionally have wanted to be as close as possible to an intergenerational pop ed conversation about who I am, how I work, the way that I've worked in Roots, why, and whatever else, because the young people have chosen to send in questions because coronavirus keeps us from talking together. So here goes. I first became connected to alternate roots. I learned about alternate roots in 2001. It was an emergency meeting after September 11th. The meeting was at Spelman, on the campus of Spelman. And a brother named Dana Smith was working with Roots, I think, in an interim capacity. And he offered me a newsletter. It was a paper newsletter back then. And he said, I think you're supposed to be with these people. I really think you should be a part of Alternate Roots. Well, I picked up the newspaper and I looked at him, and he was really cute to me. That's why I took the newspaper. And I said to myself, don't nobody in this newspaper look like me. And so I said, thank you. And then I saw a picture of Alice Lovelace, a lady I really love and admire, and said to myself, well, maybe I'll talk to these people. But they didn't really work in Arkansas. And I was from Arkansas at that time. I was organizing in the African American Women's Institute. I was actually the lead organizer. So years went by and my friends started to join Alternate Roots. And I also started to hear about Roots more in Mississippi and Louisiana, because at that time, through my organizing work with the African American Women's Institute, I was working kind of in the South Central region of the United States. And so this was when I met other people that later became Roots, like Wendy Shenefield. I met Carlton and Maurice Turner and Jolivet Anderson. And I already knew who Hollis was. I mean, how could we be organizers and not know Hollis? Because after all, Hollis had been a student in the NAACP, and that's how he became a member of SNCC. And because I had been a young person who became politicized as an organizer around 14, I felt a calling to connect to Hollis. And I had met John O'Neill. Now, little did I know that John O'Neill had anything to do with Roots, I knew him because when I was a little kid, he used to come to my granddaddy's house. So the connection to roots kind of went around a weird kind of way. But eventually I became one of the people that helped fund artists at Roots through my work at Highlander. So in about 2004, 2005, I was hired at Highlander. And part of my responsibilities as the lead in cultural programs was the redistribution of the royalties for the song We Shall Overcome. At that time, Bruce Springsteen had just recorded We Shall Overcome, which meant that we have a lot of money to give to people. So I decided, because I had been talking to my friends in Mississippi and Louisiana and some in Memphis that had been connected to Roots, and especially in Knoxville, because I had met Miss Linda in Carpetbag in the 90s working with Jolivet Anderson. I said, I'm going to go to this Roots meeting to give this money away. This was also the first time they had the Hip Hop Scholars meeting. So when I arrived, or when I first had the conversation, I had to pay my Roots registration like I was a real philanthropic partner. So I remember my first meeting registration being $750. And I thought to myself, wow, this might take a lot of my budget, because really Highlander hadn't been working as closely with Roots as it had in the past. And at that time, I was also the only Black education team person at Highlander, so I was also trying to figure out how to network and bring people together. Bring resources to Roots people, resources to Roots, and bring Roots to Highlander as resource people. And so that's what I did. I paid my $750 and I stayed at the really nice Conjoy, because then I was a funder and I stayed with the other funders. But the beginning of my experiences were very different than I expected, because I had met John O'Neill and I had met Linda and I hadn't even met Paula through Miss Linda. But I realized that it was an assumption that every young person of color was on a scholarship. And I didn't understand. I didn't understand what was happening, because my experience with Roots was through people of color initially. And I realized that I, if I was going to be around, wanted to help shift some of this. Not because I had a problem with people being on scholarships, but I also kind of felt like it was something that was going on that made me feel like this might not be a safe place for people of color, but that people might be persuadable, that we might be able to work together as artists who work at the nexus of art and social change to materialize a new reality, not just in Alternate Roots, but also in all of the regional organizations, because ultimately organizing is about building collective power. And so I saw that experience at Roots as being an opportunity to build collective power for everybody and pool resources from around the world to bring people together, because we really can't afford to not be together. We need everybody to be free and to work towards collective liberation and to build beloved communities. So that's my first story of how I got to Roots. Now, I was around a long time working, and over time, I joined the XCOM. I did my work, but I couldn't join the XCOM until I became a member, which I did not do, like, until Arkansas was acknowledged on the map. So I worked a long time, and people made assumptions about my membership status. And although Highlander was an organizational member, Tufara Walla Muhammad was not a member, because I wanted to make sure that I had votes and representation and that people understood that Arkansas, and particularly the Arkansas Delta and the whole state, was connected by that magical river called Mississippi to Louisiana, to Mississippi, and that we were some of the same people sharing the same culture, and that we too need to be a part of Roots, because we had been a part of Roots, but maybe people just didn't know we were from Arkansas. So that is when I joined. I can't remember the exact year, but the actual first member from Arkansas after Arkansas was voted in was Gerald Johnson. I came after Gerald because I had to wait till the next meeting. So we know there are always pieces of stories that get left out, or and sometimes it's intentional, but most of the time it's not. And so one of the things that I realized in my beginning relationship with Alternate Roots as the lead of cultural programs at Highlander is that I would talk to people and they did not know that Roots was founded at Highlander. Although Mama Linda would say it all the time, because I actually think that Mama Linda, Linda Paris Bailey, was staff at Highlander that helped to convene the people that then became the founders of Roots. So for me in the beginning, I was surprised because I felt like, and always feel like, the intersection stories and our origin stories, it, particularly when we're all connected, bring us so much power and helps to help younger people behind us understand how things evolve. So under Carlton's leadership, I have to commend him. And I felt like, particularly as a member of Highlander staff, that there were intentional things to help people make sense of the relationship and kind of the continuum of the work of the elders that then became Highlander's cultural programs and became Alternate Roots and became Hip Hop Scholars and became Greenhouse and whatever else we are working on now. Like, it is a part of our story. You know, particularly when we start thinking about the way Roots thinks about rhizomes and things growing off of this thing and things growing out of that thing and how all these things are connected. We have to tell the whole story. One, because the story gives us strength and talks about how we all had a little and now we all got a lot. And I think we only have a lot because we started to really think about the intersection and the continuum and name the names of the people that did the work, because I also think there's something that happens there, whether it's on purpose or not. We sometimes erase people from the history, the dominant narrative or whatever, and we can't afford to do any of that. So we all count. We will not be erased. Is that good? Part of the reason I chose to do the pollination this way is because I wanted to allow opportunity for young folks, because I realized it is a part of our responsibility to make places and make way for younger people. I began organizing, like knowing that I was organizing around the time that I was about 15 or 16 during the gang wars in Arkansas. However, I was always at the meetings. I was always at the meetings with my organizing family. I was always at the artist meetings with my artist family. I was always at the meetings with the culture bearers. I understand now to be culture bearers because I was with my elders. And they used to sit me in the corner. And sometimes I got to talk and sometimes I didn't. So I remember what it's like to have something to say, but not have somebody to make a place or a way for you. So my hope is to always, in every organizing effort or every effort, to make a way to work myself out of a job, to make a way for somebody younger than me to transfer whatever skills or lessons I have so that the next person can duplicate the good things that I've done and not so much of the bad things. Because what you got to do it again for? No need to repeat. I already completed that bad decision or whatever bad practice. What else do I want y'all to know? I think, and this is all my opinion, you could take it or you could let it alone. I think some of the essential practices are probably not what people think they are. I think for me, it is one of the essential things is about love, loving yourself and loving each other. And taking part in practices that help to bring that to light. I think communication is essential, and honest dialogue, which is sometimes heart conversations, H-E-A-R-T and H-A-R-D conversations, because we're socialized to not always tell the truth. But in order for us to be effective and sustainable, we have to be honest. We have to speak our truths, and we have to love each other. And I think that there are things that we can learn from those that organized before us, that did not communicate, that did not operate in love. And we can see where long-term change was made through love. And we can see where we are continuously doing some work that builds upon the work of our elders, be it here or beyond. We look at people like John Lewis, you know, who ultimately we know tried to move in love. He talked about it, and he tried to move that way, and he sustained a long time. You know, we look at people like Ella Baker, who we know loved the young people, and she made sure that she made a space. I think this is also part of that. What makes movement sustainable, because I know that one day I'm not going to be here. So part of making the movement sustainable is also transference of skills, knowledge, wisdom, and our particular analysis building together across differences. I think that's kind of timeless. It's not just I see it being essential, not just in the people that are organizing before me, the people that are organizing with me. And even when I look this way and I see younger people organizing, I see even more fierce and fearless, honest conversations that speak truth to power. And so that are also, you know, highlighting the fact that we must love one another. That's my answer to that question. I think the first thing that comes to my mind around that question has to do with the Americans with Disabilities Act. So I can remember in my movement memory as a young person watching some of my elders in Arkansas organizing and teaching me to organize as they fought for access. And they fought for what became the Americans Disabilities Act. And like fighting for dignity for differently abled persons or persons who are differently abled. We see that when we look now and the way that that organizing materialized into actual institutional changes, because we look at stuff like public transportation. I actually remember elders chaining themselves through wheelchairs in front of city buses. I actually remember seeing that. I actually remember being taught about that. So I think the organizing that happened over decades, somebody coming in the house, through America's Disability Act, that work that materialized into the long-term change changed internal policies, organizational policies. It changed interpersonal interactions with organizers and people on the streets. It's the reasons we have wide doors. It's the reason that a lot of organizations shifted the way that they did work, particularly in nonprofits. That's the first thing that came to my mind. The second thing that also came to my mind is some of the things around domestic violence and violence against women. That's also another example where there was broad scale strategy and policy and people in the streets, and where behaviors were shifted and laws were changed. The next thing I'm thinking about, it has to do with AIDS and HIV. And where I saw actual people in the streets organizing, fighting, standing next to me, teaching me. Some of them didn't make it to the end, but the laws changed. The things around discrimination, the things around access, the things around healthcare, it changed as a result of us building collective power, building collective strategy, and shifting our behaviors and forcing the institutions to shift the behaviors, the policies, and the practices. And in all of these examples, there were also huge examples of the way that people used art and culture to bring light to the issues, the laws, the policies, and the practices. What are you thinking? What are you thinking? Alicia, what you thinking? You know more about Roots. You've been in Roots longer than Nautica. What you thinking?
So this is something that came up today. So like I said, in my community, we have two neighborhoods that's going, it's like a war that's going on right now. And today we had like a, we had an event for the mothers to come out to talk about solutions, how we can stop the crimes, and nobody showed up. It was just us. So my question is, how can we get our community more involved to help us push the movement? Because that's the struggle for us now, is getting more people involved and educating them and trying to get them to help us stop the violence, stop the gangs, and things like that.
That's actually a good question, because that's something I think about as well. Like growing up in the hood and seeing all the violence, I always think about like what do we do when someone's personal will is like outpowering the whole like we need to do better conversation. So I don't know. I guess one way I would approach it is to figure out what the violence is for. Like, is there a huge problem or disagreement that's being had between the communities? And then also, like, how can we keep people safe in the process of figuring that out? Like, what's the crisis plan for making sure that folks aren't getting hit with stray bullets or, you know, that kind of thing? I don't know how to do that, but I feel like that would be my first question, is like, what can we do to make sure that people in the community that aren't doing that being protected, how do we protect them first, and then how do we address what the issue actually is? Because it might come up that it might be a resource issue. You know what I mean? It might be there are no jobs, so people are just out hanging out on the street, and that just happened to be what they're choosing to do today. I don't know. But,
We were saying earlier, not before you go, Tara, we were saying that they shut down the different basketball courts and recreation centers. So the teenagers and the kids, they're more heavy in the streets because different things, the resources that they had before, they're no longer there. Thank you.
So for me, what I would say is there's a piece around listening, you know, because when people feel heard, and they feel like you're doing what they want you to do, then they're more apt to connect to it. And that's just, you know, like people have to feel like it's their interest. So I think in my experience,
that that has been what has made my organizing most effective is when I listen deeply and I analyze collectively with other people in community. So when I start to think about like, okay, you know, or maybe I get all the mamas together who lost their kids and just say, what can we do? What would you tell other people? You know, because that's different. Or I get all the grandmamas together, you know, because most often in my community, most of the conflict in the hood is about economy. It's about money. It's about money, perceived power. The power is connected to money. Everything is always about money, resources, position that's connected to money. So I'm always like, let's figure out. That's how I started doing cooperative work and doing work around cooperative development is because I started thinking, how can we use art? You know, like in our artist collective, it's about how can we use art to create economic opportunities because all the problems in my hood around violence are about money. So if I can figure out how to teach somebody how to make the same amount of money that they make on the corner. So if I can teach you how to make $150 in 1 hour, right? And you don't have to have a lawyer. You don't have to have bail. You don't have to have none of that. Would you work with me? You know, like that's what I literally ask people. Come work with me. I bet you I could teach you how to make $150 in an hour. And you don't even have to worry about getting arrested. Let's go do this. And then you can be a worker owner. That's how I started doing cooperative work because I was like, we need to de-escalate the violence. You know, and you have to remember, I was a teenager in the middle of the gang wars. Like I came up when they was making banging in Little Rock. Like that's my, I'm from 21st Street. Where they took the recorded half of that darn thing. And that was part of what everything was about was economics. And then when people have jobs and they feel like they got a trade, they feel like they can make art and make a livable wage, then they start to operate different because this they stuff, this they hood in a different way. It gets good in the hood when everybody feel like they got a place and they're honored, they listen to and they respect it. That's my thing. We can't just produce events. And then expect community to show up. We got to do it together. And then once people feel like it's a part of them and they have to create it, then they move differently and they connect to it. And the other reality is as an organizer, if I call 150 people and 30 people come, that's good.
Yep, that's the math.
That's good. So I just be prepared to call 150 people and really call them. Mm-hmm. But like, in my mind, when I go to meet with people, I try to meet 10 people at a time, knowing that probably only one of them gonna end up turning into something. That's just the way it goes.
Yeah,
it ain't bad though.
Yeah,
because you might not get them this time or the next time, but on the fourth time, they coming.
Right, and also folks aren't always called to be involved as deeply as some of us are. That makes sense. You know what, yep. I mean? Like some folks are just, you know, they're willing to just pass out flyers. I feel like that, I think that speaks to that whole role question earlier. It's like, everybody has their part. As small as we want to think it is, everybody has a role. Whether they know it or not, it's as small as it is. But yeah. And reflecting on the piece of, I guess, creating opportunities, bringing in resources. I always think, and I've always said, especially in youth work with Project South, we have to, what are we supplementing? How are we supplementing what is not here in the community? Like I know for a lot of us that started out, we weren't being fed properly. Like food was a thing, like we didn't have no food. So I think one thing that got folks in the door was we're serving food every week, every day. Every time we have a meeting from this time to this time, there will be food. Always got people in, even if they just ate. So I don't know. I think of just what are we doing to actually supplement what's missing from communities or from the community to, I guess, help with that need or lack of.
In addition to, and Alicia, you could tell me if I'm wrong, but consistency. Because in my community, like when people feel like that you, oh, well, you're just going to be there for 2 weeks and then you're going to be gone because your grant going to run out and you're going to be there and got all your money and finish your research, then they're not going to engage.
Right.
Yeah. What you think?
So my question was, what advice would you give to anyone that is new to this work and is struggling with navigating? And do you have any educational materials to recommend, like books, podcasts, et cetera?
We can answer that together, Alicia.
Yeah. For me, I feel like a lot of people, when they're new to this work, I would tell them to get out in your community and see, and like do volunteer work and see the different things that you can get involved with. And it's, educating yourself is so important. You know, find something that you're very passionate in and push that movement out to make it even a greater movement. That would be my thing. Get into the community. See something. It's something out there in all the communities. It's something for somebody to do. It's always needed.
I would probably say get you some friends like the friends I got from Alternate Roots. Because there's always information coming out. Mm-hmm. You know, somebody is always putting out a new podcast. There's somebody always doing stuff in the networks like National Association of Latino Arts and Culture. You can be a member there. You can be a member of Roots. There are multiple organizations that are like regional organizations and regional resources that work with artists in particular, like Sib Culture in Carlton, and Roots and NILAC and National Performance Network, depending on which particular discipline you want to operate in, since you multidisciplinary artist, then you could, I would suggest that you like get on some of the mailing lists because they send out stuff all the time. And then I also would suggest that you find somebody that you feel like is doing the kind of work you want to do and ask them to mentor you.
Yep.
Ask them to mentor you. Just ask them. Everybody, some people think every time somebody is going to expect money. It's not true. It's not true. Every mentor or every person to, you know, some people are just willing to spend time with you and talk to you because they believe in what you're trying to do. And don't be mad if, you know, maybe you ask somebody and the first time they say, no, I can't do it because I got too much going on. But just keep looking and find somebody or ask them if they can't, if they don't have the capacity to be your mentor. Say, what book are you reading right now? You got a book? What's your favorite podcast? That's what I will do. And that's also what I do because I have mentors that help me, you know?
Yeah.
You know, one of the things I think about now, as the person that I am now, the age that I am now, I often think about all of the mentors that I had that in some instances was like, look, girl, go on now. or, you know, like I would ask them a question and they'd just be like, read this book. Mm-hmm. And now that I'm older, I realized that was a certain kind of mentorship where before I was like, they don't want to talk to me. But it was like they were teaching too sometimes. They just didn't have the capacity.
Yeah. And that's, I think for me, that's kind of something that discourages me a little bit from reaching out to people or trying to find someone who can kind of help me navigate a little bit through this, because I don't want to be annoying to anyone. I don't want to impose on anyone's, schedule. But
it's all right. Ask them. What's the worst thing they can do is just say no.
Right.
You know, like one of the things my people say, what they gonna do? They gonna say no. They can't kill you. It's illegal, and they can't eat you because we'll find them. You know, so it's like don't be scared. Just ask people. What can they say?
Yeah.
That's true. That is
so true.
Like don't. It's okay, and it's okay if people say no. It's not personal. A lot of times they don't have nothing to do with you. It's just about the capacity that they have. And that's okay, because we also have to develop boundaries. Like, I wish when I was younger, somebody would have talked to me about boundaries and sometimes being able to say, okay, I can do this, but I can't do this, you know? Mm-hmm. And I can get into a whole long thing about Black women and boundaries and society and socialization, but I'm not going to go there.
Yes, to the boundaries. I'm learning that as of right now. As a 23-year-old, I am learning that right now.
That's good, because I didn't get it till I was 35.
Oh, Lord.
Oh. Oh, Lord. But Oh, at least you got to go. All right, what else we got, y'all?
How do you kind of find what your role is in movement? Because I feel like everybody has a different role and different skills. And how do you find that role, for example, as an artist who does a lot of their work in the studio?
I know, okay. So I would, y'all want to go first? Let's talk about it. What do you think?
Well, initially for me, what initially came to mind for me was the part where, you know, like she said something around being in the studio or just being set in a certain space where that's where your art is created. But I think being flexible, I don't know if you can really say like have a set role. I think your role is to continue to spread or continue to build awareness through your art and build, continue to like get your message out through your art or whatever you're doing through your art that contributes to the movement. I think that is your role, but I also think to build on that, like we have to have the ability to be flexible in this work and be able to step in when it's needed, whether it's something that you're normally doing all the time, whether it's something that you're not, you know. I think it just being flexible is, I guess, the first thing I would say to that, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. Lisha, you want to go? Or you want me to go?
You go. I go last.
I was going to say, I actually think that over time, if I just talk about my own experience, I feel like my role has changed and my understanding of the way that I work. Like as somebody that has worked in different artistic disciplines, then there are times where I felt like my role was different. Like if I was painting, then my role was different. But the consistent thing, I think, in all of the, whether I'm painting or singing or, you know, making things, sewing things with my hands or cooking or whatever artistic discipline I'm using, in all instances, I have to listen and stay current and listen to what community is saying and listen to what the needs are of my community. And as somebody who sees my art as my tool, because ultimately I am an organizer, I say to myself, how can I, as an artist organizer person, use the tools that I have and the strengths that I have to change the material realities of people in my community? So I would say, I don't always know. There are times when I know, and it's very clear, and there are times when I don't know. But the consistent thing is, I have to listen, and I have to be open, and I have to be willing. What you think, Alicia?
I feel like you both had great responses. For me, if I really believe in something, you know, whatever I know I can bring to the table, I offer my support. If I have a hard time finding my role, you know, I go out in the community, I talk to the people, I listen, I educate myself. Whatever I'm trying to advocate for, and I really try to be myself. I can't be more than that. And I feel like a lot of times people, they miss that one section. Like, you have to be yourself, believe in yourself, and you'll go a long way with that. What are you smiling about?
It just made me happy because I just feel like y'all are so smart. I told you part of this whole pollination thing is so that people can see that some of us old people can sit around sometimes, because everybody younger than us is brilliant too. That's all.
I appreciate that. That's trust right there. That's trust that we can continue to do the great work. So
y'all are brilliant. I mean, I feel like our job as older people is to transfer resources. Sometimes that's skills. Sometimes that's money. Sometimes it's just opportunity for people to hear what you got to say.
Absolutely. I totally agree with that.
We got any more on Ambrose's question? Because I also think that Ambrose might have known some of the answers. She probably would have said some of the same stuff we said.
Yeah. Back to the flexibility thing, like being able to show up, being true to yourself, like Alicia said, being true to yourself and giving, like, when, I feel like when you show up to a space where there's an issue that's being, I guess, fought against or fought for, you, especially if you're new or you're just stepping in, I think it's always best to lead with just listening. You know what I mean? Like my granddad always say, be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath or slow to react. Definitely walk into spaces ready to hear and listen to folks, and also offer what you have, all that you have. That's all you can do. You know what I mean? And I think it hurts people more when you try to assume a role that you aren't even really ready for or invested in. So
go ahead.
What'd you say? With her being true to yourself.
And also being honest, like if it's something like where I say, I don't know if I know how to do that, that you get together with people and you help work to make a collective solution. Or, you know, like maybe I think this is my role and part of my, you know, having a crew of accountability crew is for somebody to be like, yo, sister, that ain't your role. You know, like,
yeah, this might not be.
You're doing a good job, but we love you and
right.
Let somebody else do that.
Yeah. And I think also, too, like not getting set in one space or one way of being, one way of showing up or existing. I think, like, speaking to your point, Tufara, like, you have to be able to evolve and grow and kind of move with what is happening as it's happening, especially as an artist in movement. Like, that is the core of art right there, is being able to transform and translate into different mediums, different ways of, you know, a message. So, yeah.
Yep. How do you find the balance between taking care of yourself and your own health when you're also called to care for your community and your family and all the needs that you're called to meet on a regular basis?
I think this is a very So my teacher, Bernice Johnson Regan, has a song called Ella's Song. And in the song, she says, we who believe in freedom cannot rest. So what I'm going to say is, I love my teacher, but I disagree in some ways. The life expectancy, and this is based on my own personal research and my own experience, the life expectancy of Black women organizers averages, in my experience, about 55. I can go and show you in cemeteries around the South, my friends and my teachers, who work themselves to death. And maybe because they were always working, didn't get to transfer information or skills or history. And so I see wellness and health and taking time to evaluate, document, transfer information as an essential part of our movement work. If you do not take care of yourself, then in some ways, and in some instances, you duplicate bad behavior that is not liberatory. And so I encourage everybody, and I have to be honest and say that I have not always done it. That too is also one of the reasons that I left Highlander, because I realized, as somebody who was coordinating a regional program that had international pieces, that I was sick, and it was irresponsible for me
to continue to do what I was doing, because young people, young women that look just like me were duplicating my behavior. And it was bad behavior. So what I strive to do now is to model what I have learned and what my elders supported me to in doing. And I have to also acknowledge the fact that it was people like Linda Paris Bailey and Yawa Awolowo, and even in some instances, Paula Lark, that said to me, you're not well and we need to figure out. And Mama Nayo, God bless her soul, who taught me, you need to slow down, you need to have some boundaries, be it taught me in good ways and taught me in bad ways. But I want to model to younger people boundaries, because we deserve it all. We deserve to live and live lives in liberated ways, to love, to experience love, to be happy, to be whole, to be well. We deserve it all. Everybody does. And white supremacy and the perpetuation of white supremacy often has us thinking that we're not worth it, and we are. We deserve it all. We deserve it all. We deserve it all. We deserve it all. I don't know if that's the answer to the question, but that's the way I feel. As I sit here thinking about, I'm going to start crying. So I'm going to stop. I'm just going to say, when I look at the people that I have lost, or the people that have transitioned, maybe I haven't lost them because I got them in my heart and I got them in my mind and I talk to them. But how different would their realities have been if they had taken time for themselves to, and if we had held our movement and each other and them accountable? Because for me, love is also about accountability. That's about saying, hey, sister, you look sick. What can we do to support you? Hey, brother, don't stress yourself out. Stress will kill you. What do we need to do to support you? I'm not building a movement. I'm building a family where we love each other so much to where we realize we can't afford for nobody to leave here. Not leave here unless they want to. I hope I answered your question.
So the invitation is for you to come up with your own question for Ms. Tuffy about, like, anything you want to know about, like, art and activism and how people can use art to, like, make the world a better place.
I want to do something really, use your words. Smart.
Okay.
Don't record me yet. I'm still thinking. Ooh, I know. If the world had no colors, what color would the world be?
Mm-hmm.
That's just real, like, it can't be blank, because then that's clear, and clear is a color.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, and it can't be death, because you don't see anything. Like, what would it be? That's a big question, right?
It is a big question.
Like, white? I don't even know the answer. No, white is a color.
Do you have any questions about, like, how you can use art to, like, have the kind of world that you think?
Well, that's going to be one of my questions, you know.
Oh, go ahead.
It's going to be the question that I say.
Well, what's your question for Tuffy?
Again? Okay. What color would the world be if there were no colors in the world?
Okay. Do you have any other questions for Tuffy?
Well, that was going to be the one that I was going to ask her so she can think about it. And now I shall... Okay, now I'm going to do, like, one of my practice questions.
Okay.
Okay. The color of the water depends on the health of the world. Oh, no, that's not a question.
You can talk about the health of the world and art if you have questions about that.
But that's not the question.
She's sleepy.
Brilliant. Just brilliant.
So,
what would the world be?
what color would the world be if there were no colors? I actually am unsure. But if I had to pick something other than color for the world to be, I would say it would be a pattern. And the pattern might be more of a paisley.
Every living organism on this planet needs water to survive in some way. And so if the water is showing signs of pollution, that definitely, I think, can definitely say, like, obviously the people are somehow polluted in any way. But, yeah.
I hope. What they said.
Yeah.
Where does she get all the fun?
What do you mean she get all the fun?
She gets to answer the questions. I wish that she was asking us to answer the questions. She asks us to answer the questions.
All right. Well, sleep on it some.
Wait a second. If there was no color in the world, then the world would be every color. Because no color and every color. No color doesn't mean that it's not a new color. And new color doesn't mean that it's not every color. So if the world was no color, it would be every color. Do you get it?
I don't know. We'll see if Miss Tuffy gets it.
Okay. I get it. I think she made a very valid statement, and I agree.
Yep.
Who wants to argue with a 5-year? They the boss.
And if you apply that to different, like, scenarios or situations, I think what it ultimately means is taking away that layer of, like, preconception, bias, all of that, and really approaching it at the root of whatever the issue or situation is. We talk about, like, not racism, what I was going to say. I forgot what I was going to say just now. But to that extent of, like, you get an opportunity to truly show up without wondering or thinking about those things that kind of come with, you know, preset social constructs.
I think that's a great analysis of that statement Sailor made. And I also want to say, because she also said, why does Miss Tuffy get to have all the fun? And I would say, I get to have more fun because I'm older. And the other part of that question is, why does she get to answer all the questions? And I don't want to answer all the questions. That's why we're doing this like this. I love you, Sailor. Thank you. So this is the thing I want to ask y'all. If in fact resources were unlimited and you as an individual artist, organizer, community worker could do anything, what would you do? If resources were unlimited, if it wasn't like you didn't have, you know, you didn't have a budget and you could just work to do the work you want to do in your community, what would you do?
Is this more of like pertaining to personal work that speaks to the greater work? Or is this like, what would you contribute in general to the greater work?
I think it's up to you and your interpretation of the question that I asked you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But just know we only got like 8 more minutes.
Okay. Gotcha. I guess I have 2 responses. I guess the first one would be like on a more personal, like my creation. I mean, I guess that would just mean that I would have the space and opportunity to truly create something that is big, or, you know what I mean? Like something that I haven't had the resources to even like think about doing, and now that I have the resources available, I can get it done and do that. So I think like that on that personal level, to not get too specific, but on that personal level, but on more of a broader communal level, I think providing, sharing those resources in any way possible. So if it's money, how we've investing that money into programs, art programs in schools, are we creating after school programs that actually cultivate and grow creativity in young folks? Like, that's something that I would do with unlimited resources. It's interesting because it's a vague question. It's not a very specific question, which is great, but that would be my vague answer to that question is I would reallocate those that money or resources or materials to spaces that need them. Like, there are already art spaces, artivist, activist movement spaces that need those resources. So if they were presented to me, I'm definitely sharing.
What you think, Alicia?
I agree with you totally. For me, in my community, I will like make a safe space for children and teenagers to go to because we don't have a lot of that there. Like, I also work with Teens with a Purpose, and if I can put more TWPs around Norfolk and in the Hampton Roads area, that's what I would do with those resources because it's really needed. Like right now, the violence is, we have two communities fighting each other. So, you know, if we had more recreation centers and places they can go to, it would be less crimes. They're less out in the streets trying to fight and killing each other. So hopefully one day we do get the resources so that we can provide those opportunities to those young people.
Yeah. I don't think that I would say anything different than what y'all said, because I feel like that is a somebody that's been doing this work for a while. I kind of feel like that's my role, not to get to try to do as much as I can to get the resources to try to redistribute them.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, because like Alicia, before you got on this call, I was talking to them about what's going on in my community, and it sounds like what's going on in your community too. So yeah. If resources, like monetary resources and resources for artists was unlimited and I could figure out how to channel them, then I know that our communities would change because people just need it. Yeah. They need to be able to visualize, like art helps you to visualize a different reality. Mm-hmm. And once you visualize it, you can materialize it. That's my two cents. Thanks for answering my question.
Art is also an opportunity to kind of purge emotions and feelings and thoughts in a way where it's nonviolent. So I definitely totally agree with that. Absolutely.
Cool. What else?
My question is this. When was the moment when you realized that music was essential to organizing, not just everyone, but especially youth and young adults?
I would have to say that I knew it from the time I was a young person. Because, like I said earlier, I would often be at these meetings, and one of the things that I realized, being, you know, a fifth generation community worker, is all of the power that came when we joined our forces and our voices together. Because there was not one meeting that ever happened where it wasn't certain things that happened. So we sang every community meeting. We prayed every community meeting. If I had to count how many times we said the Pledge of Allegiance, or saying lift every voice and sing, it was always there. So for me, I don't think we're organizing well if we're not including elements of music when we can. Because a lot of times before people can join their forces, they can join the voices. It's the first step around coming together. And then even if you're singing, you think about it, people, when you're singing and you're projecting your voice, they reach your voice before they even reach your body. There's something to that. The energy, the essence of what you're trying to do, particularly when you're doing it with intention. So I think that from the time I was a little kid, I knew, or a little child, I knew. Now, I might not have said this is about organizing, but I knew it was about building power. And for me, organizing is always about building collective power and figuring out the ways that we can move together to create the reality and change our material realities for the better, for not just me, but for everybody. So I knew from the time I was a little kid. Now, another part of this question could be, I didn't realize that people actually didn't understand. Other people didn't understand. That's also, I knew from the time I was, because it's a part of our culture, but I didn't realize that people didn't understand that it was a central part of organizing until I was almost 40 years old. I was like, what's wrong with these people? Is that an answer?
Young and old together, we shall not be moved. Young and old together, we shall not be moved. Just like a tree just planted by the water, we shall not be moved. Fighting for our freedom, we shall not be moved. Fighting for our freedom, we shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, we shall not be moved. Hey! Fighting for our freedom, we shall not be moved. Fighting for our freedom, we shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, we shall not be moved.
So, when I was younger, I used to want people to ask me my opinion on stuff. I used to want people to say, well, Tuffy, what do you think? So I'm asking, what can we do as people regionally and nationally to help to fortify the efforts of young folks or younger people? Not to tokenize young people, but to help catapult the work that you want to do. Because in my particular cultural tradition, we say, old men, old people for counsel, young people for war. Now, it might sound violent to other people, but it is my spiritual practice. So I say to you all, what do we need to do so that you all can do what you need to do? What tools do we need to provide? What support do we need to provide? What resources? Because we know, because we've been young before, unless we forgot. And hopefully, we will get older, and so will you. So what do we need to give you so that we can make sure we transfer skills and information across ages, across locations, across identities, so that we can be a collective power towards freedom and liberation?
Thanks to all the presenters this morning, to Tufara and Kayla and everyone else who is part of the presentations. Let's show them some affirmations and some gratitude in the chat.
And Paige, I have to take a point of order and also say a huge thank you to Lauren Fitzgerald, the co-creator, the co-curator of Roots. I'm sorry, we had a little technical sit, but Lauren did all the editing for Tufara's keynote. So huge thanks to Lauren for that.
Thank you, Lauren. It was beautiful.
Truly, truly beautiful, really exciting. Let's really give gratitude and affirmation to everyone who supported this session, to the tech team, to Banchalengas for holding down interpretation, to the root staff, and for each and all who've received this from Tufara and the wonderful young people that she was working with today. They have entered into our ears something that is precious, something that is sustainable, something that gives life. I'm not sure exactly what next steps are called for, but certainly a moment of gratitude and a moment of praise.
So I think we have a message from a member of the Roots community.
Yes, I think we have the Davis video coming up next.
Oh, yes. Video.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Roots Week. I'm Ashley Walden Davis, and this is
Eden Davis.
And we want to come here today from our homeschool classroom, as well as the headquarters of Unlock Creative. And we want to let you know how special Alternate Roots is and all the amazing things
say,
Paige, that Alternate
I've
Roots
been
does for the community.
By,
this week at Roots Week,
reminding
you'll see that it's taking place over a
basic,
couple of months.
Some really wonderfully basic
it in a different
things.
Way.
Organizing is
pandemic.
About building
the
collective
staff has been
power.
Working very, very hard.
And then she turned right around and said, I'm not
again,
building a movement. I'm building
you.
A family.
You know, we ask, yes,
and I think
that you
those two things together
$5
are so important.
To $2,500 or even $25,000. Yeah! If you haven't.
We're all
so,
building family.
Again, you know me, all about money for the mission. But again, just wanted to come back and take an opportunity to say thank you to Alternate Roots and to you, the members, and ask you to support. Have an amazing day.
Bye.
Happy Roots Week.
A few more things before we wrap things up.
I must admit to being a bit confused. I just think the time we had with Tuffy and the young people that she was working with is just absolutely precious and to be treasured, and so much gratitude. I know that everybody has found it to be powerful. Jeff Becker speaking out from down there in his studio. Everybody out there getting so much love coming at us this morning. Love and wisdom.
So remember to check your daily email for details. Thank you all for coming today. This afternoon, we're going to be starting about 30 minutes later than usual. So that'll be 2:30 Central and 3:30 Eastern for a panel with our extraordinary elders. And also wanted to remind you that the new voting member voting in process will take place tomorrow afternoon at 2 Central, 3 Eastern. And so if you're interested in signing up for voting membership, you can go to our website to get some details on what that entails and what you're signing up for. Or also you can email membership@alternateroots.org. So we're going to close out with some music from our favorites, Liza Garza and Eli Lakes, performing as Grow. So thanks to all of you, and we will see you later this afternoon.
Beautiful. See you all later.
Here we go. living. Flowers for the 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 living. I don't hesitate when it comes to love. I know time waits for no one. I don't hesitate when it comes to love. I know time waits for no one. Flowers for the living. Flowers for the living. Flowers for the living.
Yeah. Ain't no sense in waiting.
My sweet obligation.
Right.
Divine inspiration. That's what I've been thinking.
Yes.
Ain't no sense in waiting. My sweet obligation.
Come on.
Divine inspiration. That's what I've been thinking. Flowers for the living.
Come on.
Flowers for the living. 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 Flowers for the living.
Back to ain't no sense in waiting. Ain't no sense in waiting.
My sweet obligation.
Yes.
Divine inspiration. That's what I've been thinking. Ain't no sense in waiting. My sweet obligation. Divine inspiration. That's what I've been thinking. Yeah.
Flowers for the living, because you and I are living.
Flowers for the living, because you and I are living.
Flowers for the living, because you and I are living.
Flowers for the living. Flowers for the living. For the living.
Flowers for the living, because you and I are living.
Flowers for the living. Flowers for the living. For the living.
Flowers for the living, because you and I are living. Flowers for the living. Flowers for the living. For the loving, never growing, for the living, for the loving, shed flowers for the living, because you and I are living. Flowers for the living, they are ever giving, never loving, never giving, always growing. Where's your garden? Yeah. Flowers for the living, because you and I are living. Flowers for the living, because you and I
live. Flowers for the living, flowers for the living,
for the
living,
for the living, for the living.
Flowers for. for the living. Flowers for the living.
Come on, ground us with that. Ground us with that.
Flowers for the living.
Come on, what else is there but love?
Flowers for the living.
What else is there but to move forward to your
flowers
lover?
Flowers for the living.
To the people that you love.
Flowers for the living.
For the justice that you love.
Flowers for the living.
For the ancestors.
Flowers for the living.
One more time. Ain't no sense in waiting. Don't put it off.
My sweet obligation.
Come on.
Divine inspiration.
It's a divine inspired feeling.
That's what I've been thinking.
Yes.
Ain't no sense in waiting. My sweet obligation. Divine inspiration. That's what I've been thinking.